Welcome, everybody. This is a part of a policy hack session that we do at iSpirit. And this is, I don't know which one we are doing now, and so on. But this is on a topic that, is of interest to so many of us, and which is about the new regulations or new guidelines on the OSP regulation, which has come up. A fantastic thing, which is being lauded by the industry a lot, and we are going to talk about it in this session. And let me introduce the panelist, and it's more of a panel discussion. We expect that some expert views will emerge, and we can then post it as a blog, both as a video as well as a text blog on iSpirit blog. So that's what we do with many of these announcements in government policy, or wherever there are pain points and we want to discuss, we do that also. Let me start with the welcome and introduction for all the panelists. So for myself, I am Sudhir Singh. So I have been running this policy hack sessions. Normally, I'm a host. Sometimes I do talk on the topics that are of interest to me. This is one of the topics where I have dirtied my hands earlier in my life. So I can speak about it, but I think there are more knowledgeable people here to talk about it, right? So we will get to the panelists one by one. So for a short introduction, Arish Sharmaji is here, the ex-chairman of TRAI. And I think under him, a lot of important consultation have happened on the telecom regulation. And he has really pushed the reform side in the telecom regulation very hard, and I think we are happy to have him here. And so we will hear from him shortly. We have other panelists here. I would request Rahul Choco and Nax to introduce yourself one by one.
So my name is Rahul Mathan. I'm a partner with the law firm TriLegal, and I do a lot of work on technology, so that's telecom, internet, privacy.
Hi, Choco Valiappa, founder and CEO of V Technologies, BPO, focused in healthcare and engineering design services.
Hi, I'm Nagarajan. I'm one of the co-founders of 24/7.ai. We are into chat and call centers and call center related software products.
Great. So thank you, everybody. To take this further, can I request Rahul, if you could just summarize us in a short introduction of what this new guideline is about?
Sure. So most people don't know about this area of regulation, but this is the OSP or the other service provider regulation, which in essence regulates business process outsourcing companies. The definition of the types of entities that are regulated by this is very important. Earlier the definition used to include things like call centers, business process outsourcing activities, but it also had very broad language at the end, which included all IT-enabled services. So the first amendment that has happened is that it's been restricted now to voice-based business process outsourcing services. The second very significant amendment that has happened is that the registration requirement has been entirely removed. So earlier, if you were a qualifying entity, you had to register with the DOT, with the term cell of the DOT, and that requirement has been entirely removed. The next significant amendment is that there used to be very specific, site-specific regulations and work-from-home regulations, which means that you had to perform these services in the site. And if you wanted to perform these services from home, you needed to get specific permission for that. You also need to submit network diagrams. You needed to use static IP addresses. That whole thing has been removed. In fact, it's been changed to a work-from-anywhere kind of a framework. Also, infrastructure sharing has been permitted. There are some significant changes in the interconnectivity regulations that have been permitted. there used to be this principle of requiring to submit bank guarantees for your performance bank guarantees, which ran into the craws for many large companies. That requirement for submitting performance bank guarantees has been removed. And then in general, the provisions with regard to penalty, the provisions with regard to inspection have been removed. In fact, that entire chapter with regard to penalties and inspection has been removed. So, you know, in essence, it was a long, complicated regulation, which has now been reduced to a 7-page regulation. And I think it's 7 pages also because the spacing was not okay. And in some of those pages have just 3 points. So it is a radically simplified regulation from what it used to be.
Thank you, Rahul. And I can definitely, you know, vouch for your words over there, because I have been involved in some of the offshore center setups in India. And, you know, it was a big pain to bring in or set up the telecom part of the infrastructure. And, you know, the hassles that you go through, the more of a bureaucratic process rather than explaining the technology and the use of technology. And especially when you had to set up multiple centers, you know, it really created a lot of problem for you. So definitely, I would say that it's a big reform that which has happened. And as you said, it has simplified a lot in 7-page document. I would move on to Arish Sharmaji. And I think we would like to hear from you because, I mean, you know, he has played a big role in the remaining connected, you know, telecom policy, apart from the consultation which happened on the OSP regulation part itself. How can we gain from this? What is the impact of the industry and the economy at large, what he thinks about?
Well, thank you, Sudhir. And of course, Rahul has very beautifully summarized the developments which have taken place. Let me sort of recount a little bit of history in this. This regulation, you know, this whole rules were quite old. And September 2018, about 2 years back, the Department of Telecom gave a reference to TRAI to kind of look into these you know, regulations relating to OSPs. And of course, we had to ask for some information. So in December of 2018, they provided us some additional information. We actually issued, the TRAI issued, not, I should not say we now, but TRAI issued a consultation paper in March of 2019. And we provided these recommendations in the first week of October 2019 to the Department of Telecom. So it's about 1 year back that we provided the recommendations. The main thought of these recommendations, the main focus on these recommendations was that after all these OSPs, of course, the definition, as Rahul rightly pointed out, definition has been now changed. And I'll elaborate on that a little while later. But essentially, the thought which we had was that after all, who are these guys, the other service providers? They are actually the people who have entities who have taken resources from the telecom service providers. Now, they are using these resources to do some of the stuff which they are expected to do, like, you know, banking, telemedicine, I mean, all those BPO operations and medical transcripts and all that whole sort of issues. So essentially, we said that, look, why? I mean, they are not really going to pay any money to the government. After all, they are the ones who are the customers of the telecom. So like, I am a customer of the telecom. And if you are putting too many burdens on me as being a customer so that I don't violate the guidelines for a customer, it is actually too much to, you know, too much compliance. I mean, why should that be there? After all, they are paying money to the main service provider, which is the TSPs. And if there is any violation on their rights, you know, for example, if they start doing something which the TSPs are doing, then TSPs will be more worried. You know, there is a conflict, you know, there is a situation where there is already an incentive disalignment in some sense, and they will be the one who will be looking for protecting their interests. So why should we really come in between and, you know, ask for all kinds of, you know, compliance from these guys? So essentially, that was a broad thought process in our mind. And then we went into this whole issue of, you know, with that thought process, I mean, of course, we had not pre-decided this issue, but we basically discussed initially, and our thought was, why should we really do it? Because they are merely customers like any other customer of telecom service providers or ISPs. So therefore, we should not burden them with too much of compliance. Then, you know, we went one by one. So as Rahul rightly pointed out, one is we went into the definition. So definition was that, you know, they should be all application service providers, you know, provide, and there was a list of whole set of applications. So we actually just kind of changed that, saying that these are the entities which are taking resources from the telecom service providers or ISPs and actually doing somebody's work, you know, providing services to some other entity. So, and all kinds of, you know, these applications, and we listed out and we said that this is the basically OSPs. Now, unfortunately, the OSPs also included those people who were actually providing services internally, you know, they're large corporation and they are doing their own things in a EPA BX or, you know, OSP manner. They were also included. And we said, no, any entity which provides service to itself after taking resources from the telecom service providers will not be coming within the definition of OSP, which is quite logical. So that's one part, is we basically took care of the definition. Then secondly, we said that, you know, you are all going to, you know, registration, everybody is registered. So we said, no, only voice-based OSPs need to be registered. Data-based OSPs need not be registered at all. So that's one which we had said. There was another requirement of, you know, network diagram, saying that, you know, you have to get the network diagram countersigned by the TSP from whom you are taking services. Now that, in a way, you know what they did, TSPs were actually misusing that thing to ensure that hum tumhara network diagram theek nahi karenge, ye theek nahi hai, wo theek nahi hai. They were putting all kinds of stuff. That we had said it should go away. Similarly, there are some guys, some entities which are now providing services to set up these, you know, things. For example, call center facilities by call contact center service provider, CCSPs, hosted contact center service provider, which means, you know, these guys provide these services to the OSPs in a way, you know, they provide just the switching facilities, etc. OSPs still take the resources from the TSPs or ISPs. But they basically, it's like a contact center or OSP on a cloud. Now they are not really, they're just providing this, you know, shared infrastructure, and they are serving many OSPs. They need not be into this picture at all. After all, it is OSP who is taking resources from TSP, and that's the way it's going. So we said this is also really not, they also don't need to be within the mischief of these guidelines. So that's one part. Then of course, work from home, as Rahul rightly said, yeah, there were a lot of complications that, you know, you do work from home, then you do a guarantee, and then you take permission, etc. Fortunately, DOT itself actually had relaxed it during the period of pandemic, but we said there's no need for such. And the most mischievous situation was a bank guarantee. Now, our argument was that, friends, these guys don't pay anything to you, right? They are paying it to TSPs. Now, why should you have, what for are you having bank guarantee? The idea was that we are having bank guarantee because suppose they commit some violation, then we will be able to encash the bank guarantee. I said, this is like, you know, I didn't say, but basically we discussed among ourselves, and we said, look, it is like saying that I'll take bank guarantee from every Indian citizen that whenever he commits a crime, I am not going to bother about the, you know, warrants and other kinds of stuff. I'll just encash that bank guarantee. I mean, how can you do that? This is ridiculous. You know, you do the bank guarantee in order to ensure realization of your revenue. But once those guys are not paying any revenue, why the hell there should be a bank guarantee? So essentially, this bank guarantee business was most, and it did not serve any purpose. And interestingly, you will be surprised to know, within the last 10 years, not even a single bank guarantee has been encashed. This also shows that there was, I mean, this bank guarantee, who benefits? Only the banks benefit. Neither the government benefits, nor that OSP benefits. He's in fact being put to loss. Government does not benefit, and his loss is being, you know, sort of enjoyed by the banks. So this bank guarantee business was a completely non-required business, which we said we should not allow. Interconnectivity among the various OSPs, that also we said that should be allowed. ISP connections, for example, if there is a OSP which is having multiple centers and they want to have, you know, same from the same ISP, then the requirement was that no, the same ISP will be able to provide him only for that particular, you know, LSA for which he has a license. Now, this also is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, you can't have geographical this kind of situation. I said, you take it from one ISP, you can declare that this is my headquarter and I'll take it for all my OSPs, and that's the end of it. Once you are allowed interconnection, then you can, you know, go anywhere to anywhere. So I think we had made these recommendations about a year back, and network diagram was not required, bank guarantee was not required, interconnection was allowed, CCSP, etc. They were to be, you know, they were to function. So whole set of things we had provided to the Department of Telecom, and now it is a pleasant surprise that not only our recommendations have been accepted in toto, you know, mutatis mutandis, as Rahul would like to say, but also they have been actually, you know, the registration requirement, even from the voice-based OSPs, it's a very welcome thing. Look, we are unnecessarily complicating the life of our own people. You know, in today's world, when we are competing with and fortunately we have, you know, I don't know what the latest figures are, but 52% of BPO business was with India till a couple of years back. Maybe that figure is still there or not. I mean, I've really not updated myself on that. But I think it's a very, very significant market. And if we become such bureaucratic and such complicated, you know, country, then we are sure going to lose this business. So I think I'm very happy, and I also tweeted, and I feel, you know, really satisfied that, you know, interestingly, the once the TRAI recommendations are accepted, it is not the TRAI who is given the credit, it's the government, and rightly so. I mean, TRAI is only a recommending body which had recommended it. But I'm happy, you know, that TRAI was a part of this reform, which should have been, you know, anyway, better late than never. But this is what was needed. This has been done. It's an extremely wonderful reform by the government, and I'm sure it will benefit all of us here. It will benefit the country. It will benefit our industry, our BPO players, and everybody. So I mean, I just wanted to share that sort of my sense of you know, happiness at this whole thing. Thank you. Thank you, Sudhir.
Thank you, sir. I, you know, we all agree that, you know, government has taken a beautiful step and it's really going to benefit the industry in a big way. And especially because, you know, we were not at par with the developed world in doing all these things, right? So, and we have to do, I mean, our operations, our policies, our, you know, the way we act on ground has to be same as the developed world is. Only then we can expect their business to come to India. And this was, you know, one of the bottlenecks was that telecom is one big piece when people set up in India, right? Even for the Indian industry, it's a big piece to operate globally. And this was a big bottleneck that we had to face in the whole operation in the telecom. So we agree that, you know, government has really done a beautiful job. But Rahul, you have been involved on the legal side of it, regulatory side of it. Maybe you can throw more light on the regulatory aspect of this particular reform that has happened.
Sure. And, you know, I just want to, before I do that, just go slightly further back in history than Mr. Ramsevak Sharma just did. If you recall why this regulation was brought in, you have to go back to 15 years, because 15 years ago, data was really scarce. And what they were doing was the DoT was actually giving a special dispensation to this OSP business to encourage it, to say, look, I will allow you to bring voice calls into India on data. It's not allowed anywhere, but I'm going to give you the special dispensation to bring voice calls into India over the data network. And then you can understand why the performance bank guarantee in a sense was required, because they were actually giving these scarce telecom resources. And so they wanted some sort of a performance guarantee such that you don't violate or misuse it. But that is 15 years ago. Today, I can get on my mobile phone faster internet connections than many of these ISPs can provide me in my office. And I mean, I'm being facetious, but the point is that data today is not a scarce resource. And I think that is the beauty of this reform, because we had, in a sense, we had not seen that history had changed and we have to move. And so we kept regulations that applied to our IT industry, which was not applying to the normal man on the street, when the original intention was to give the IT industry some edge that the normal man didn't get. And in a sense, somewhere in the middle, it all got reversed. So I'm going to just talk about two or three things just to expand on what Mr. Arya Sharma said, to talk about just the difficulties that people have had as they have as we've tried to implement this. I think the big challenge was the work from home. And let me just expand on the point of our mobile phones today are smartphones. Our smartphones, most of us do a lot of work on our smartphones. So if you are using your smartphone in the office, it is office work. But if you carry it out to your car or if you go to your home, it becomes work from home. That logic didn't seem to make sense in the current world. And that was really the challenge. A lot of my clients were saying, look, if I'm doing a call center and I've got some call center agents who are sitting at home and calling, I can completely understand. But this regulation also applies to data. It applies to the work that I'm doing on my mobile phone or on my laptop. And once the distinction between mobile phone and laptop vanished, it became even more challenging. So that regulation was a big, big problem, because it even applied to the CEO of the BPO company. And the CEO is actually not doing call center work. He's only managing the company. And in the pandemic, it became extremely challenging because, of course, they gave a dispensation and a relaxation, but there were requirement that all work from home agents needed to be given static IP addresses. And in the pandemic, when everyone went work from home, the country ran out of static IP addresses. There were no static IP addresses left to allocate, which means the telecom companies had to give dynamic IP addresses, and there was a whole, but the DoT realized, the DoT came in and they gave the relaxation, and I'm really glad that that work from home restriction has gone. This interconnection between voice and data was another thing that was a big problem. So in every office, and I'm sure Choco and Nags will talk about this in their own setups, but you had to have an EPABX. The EPABX had to have a logical separation between voice calls and data calls. DoT inspectors would come from the term cell to actually inspect to see if you had connected this. Now, in today's world, I can decide on my mobile phone whether to make a call on my cellular network or on WhatsApp or on any number of other services that can give me the best quality depending on whether my cell network is better or my Wi-Fi network is better. Now, that kind of flexibility is allowed to the layperson, but in the company, in these cutting edge tech companies, they still have to have this physical box that is separating these two and be subject to inspection. So that's the last point that I'd like to make, which is just the harassment that this led to. This is not terrible harassment, but I know companies that have people who, after the regulation, they called me and said, look, I don't know if I'm going to have a job left, because 2/3 of my job was dealing with OSP compliances. And now that this has become so simplified, I don't know. They were just joking. But the point is that companies had to dedicate tremendous resources, because many of these companies have 20, 30 OSPs, 3,000, 4,000, some have 100,000 employees scattered around the country. That's a tremendous amount of compliance burden for actually an industry and a sector that should not be regulated. So I actually want to end with a question. I don't know if Mr. Ramsevak Sharma will answer this or not, but given the way in which this has been radically reduced, my question is, can we expect to actually completely eliminate this at some point in time? At this point in time, there's no registration requirement. All we have is a requirement for voice-based call centers to comply with certain obligations. Those obligations essentially are not to do toll bypass. Toll bypass is not to use this to become a mini telco, and to help the government in tracing any illegal content or anything like that. Now, both these obligations apply equally to OSP companies and to me. In my firm, I am not allowed to misuse my telecom resources to do any of these things. So the question is it possible? I think it may be too much to expect for this to be repealed overnight. But is this stage one to eventually a total repeal of these regulations, which would then make this a level playing field with other companies and just make this easier? So I will stop there, but I'm happy to hear. Actually, I'm even happy to hear what Nags and Choco have to say about that. Would this be minimal compliance? Would be sufficient, or would it be good to just have it completely removed?
No, we are really happy with what has happened. Right, it's like it's a huge reform, which is going to have far-reaching impact on the industry. We are really happy with what has happened. Right, Of course, if you're going to give us a little more, we will take it. We're not going to say no, right? So definitely, can I go next? You have...
Please continue, I think.
So want to start first with thanking Mr. Sharma for helping us, and of course, Rahul and the whole iSpirit team for, doing your bit, right? 24/7, we are a 20-year-old company, with more than 10,000 people in 8 countries. So none of the other countries we are in, be it the Western developed nations, as Sudhir was saying earlier, or the smaller developing nations we are in, like Philippines or Guatemala or Colombia, none of these countries have any of these regulations. So it is unique to our nation. While we are the leaders in the industry we are in, call centers and voice chat, data call centers, BPO, we have all these shackles we had to work through, right? Such antiquated rules are only hurting the industry by not letting us expand freely within the country, right? So if you look at Colombia, we are in 3 cities in Colombia. If you look at Philippines, we have 3 centers across metro and rural urban Manila, right? For example, right? But even though we have the largest workforce in India, in our own company, we have only 2 centers. In 2 cities. It's not because of lack of business. We have enough clients willing to give us business in India. But the fatigue of going through such regulations, I'm not just saying this one alone, right? There are a few more, but this one was the main one, right? A huge discouragement to expand our business in multiple locations, right? Of course, we consider ourselves as a mid-sized company with so many thousand people. If we feel this way, imagine smaller companies, what they would be going through as the shackles, right? Of course, the pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic forces all to move most of our work home. While it was a breeze in all other locations, in India, of course, even though the regulators gave us the permission to work from home with all the temporary, concessions, so to say, they were kept on extending. And we were always worried, hey, how long is this going to go for, right? What is the end to this? Is it going to be permanently done, or, is it going to be a constant play, right? Whereas when we moved to work from home, we realized that this model, even for a real-time delivery industry like us, which is call center industry, we are able to work from home very, very well without skipping a beat, without skipping any performance, or without even dropping employee engagement for that matter, right? So that said, now we all want to distribute our workforce as much as possible. We want to expand to second and third tier cities, urban, rural, wherever it is, and then let them work from anywhere as they want. So the timing for these policy changes could not have been more appropriate for our industry, especially when the other countries are moving towards this we've already moved towards this, especially for global players like us, right? If we didn't see these regulatory changes come in this season, which is very, very appropriate timing, we would have expanded in other countries with work from home models. It would have stunted our growth in India. It would have definitely stunted our growth in India. I'm not talking for myself, I'm talking for the whole industry, I would say, right? It would have held back our growth against the other countries, right? So the impact of this liberation in my mind won't be felt immediately, but it's going to take a few years, right? It's going to take our jobs, our jobs being very global jobs, clean, non-polluting jobs, to the nooks and corners of the nation. Our team is already planning for different 15, 16 microsites and hub and spoke model with work from home, work from anywhere kind of concept, right? So this is also going to bring new kind of talent pool into the mix, right? New kind of players into the talent pool, so to say, right? For example, suburban or a rural homemaker can now participate in this industry, right? Who can, you know, they can make good money with part-time work, maybe, right? Or part-time students, for that matter. Anyone can join this revolution of work from anywhere, so to say. The potential is exponentially greater when we are able to distribute the workforce, especially without the hassles of all the regulatory shackles. Imagine having to file all this for each and every home, right? It's like a nightmare, right? So while I still believe in that, you know, we cannot build companies sitting at home. We cannot build a company sitting at home. We can definitely work from home, right? And it's here to stay, that model. And this policy change is going to be a catalyst, definitely, for the growth, right? And I'm very, very confident that, you know, we can soon double the talent pool availability, thereby reducing the attrition levels that plague the industry, right? So attrition has its own bane, right? Quality suffers, all that kind of stuff, and competitiveness, wage inflation, all that stuff. Right? So this has many benefits for us in all dimensions, one leading to the other. For example, ease of doing business, geo-competitiveness, location diversity, workforce diversity, talent pool expansion, increased quality of delivery through attrition, reduced attrition, that is, right, retaining people, and that actually gives us back geo-competitiveness, the quality, of course, right, and thereby increasing our business potential for the country, you know, export business potential for the country, right? So that's what I feel from the industry point of view, and I feel we can create millions of more direct and indirect jobs, right? Such initiatives, I'm sure, which can help us create more and more good jobs in droves, right, are much more valuable than monetary stimulus that the government can give us, right? I don't know how much it costs to, you know, do away with such archaic, antiquated rules. I would assume zero. In fact, it'd be a cost-saving measure, right, for moving away so many jobs, right? So that said, such low-cost, zero-cost initiatives are so many there in our country that can give us better stimulus to the economy than just, you know, monetary stimulus. Thank you so much again, sir. Thank you so much. That's all I had to say.
Thank you, Nags. I think you had rightly put in the perspective of, you know, the economic impact that it will make, especially to the tier two and tier three cities in India and creating jobs over there. I think the job creation will probably the best impact that it will have on the economy, right? Industry is already, I mean, the entire IT and ITS industry is already doing work from home. And I think it is the need for work from home which has slightly given a push, right? All the work that iSpirit team, Rahul and other people were doing that has helped us. Sharmaji had put a consultation paper that was there. But I think the credit goes to the leadership of this country today. And I think they saw that this is required and it should be done immediately. And as you said rightly, industry, I think stimuluses do help, but more than stimuluses, what we are looking for are reforms, I mean, which can help in the operations, not only setting up. So mostly when we look at EOB, you know, ease of doing business issues, we look at easier to set up in India. And that's where we start ranking. But that is definitely important. But nonetheless, making it easier to operate is very, very important. And this particular reform makes it very easy to operate on ground from the telecom infrastructure point of view, you know, especially for the voice-based operation, but also for the other IT and ITS industry, because data and voice have merged now. I mean, they had long back merged, but nobody is taking a call based on that. And we're looking for them. This is not the platform to speak about them, but let us learn more from Choco, what are his views and how would the BPO industry be benefited from this particular reform. Choco, please, can you elaborate and help us and guide us?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Sudhir Sharma. Hello, Sharmaji. Hello, Rahul and Nags. It's great to be here today. I almost feel like Forrest Gump, in the movie Forrest Gump, because 1984, when the then Prime Minister gave a red carpet welcome to Texas Instruments to set up their shop in India, the first IT company. They were given a red carpet welcome, which meant that they could bring in the satellite Earth station, and that came into Sona Towers, which was our building then. And then later, the satellite got bought over by a company called VSNL, and that's how the VSNL started in 84. And so much so that when Texas Instruments set up their branch in India, I think perhaps 6 years or 10 years after they started in 96 or 94 or something like that, across the road, they couldn't get bandwidth because they had to get a lot of regulation and things like that. So we worked a lot with the then secretary, Mr. N. Whittle, and in terms of trying to get line of sight, special clearance or whatever. So that's how we watched the red carpet becoming red tape in that process. So. And in 1996, I co-founded the first ISP, the software technology park, and brought in a lot of US-based companies like Oracle and Cisco. And I still remember getting the first bandwidth for Wii Technologies almost 20 years ago. We had to pay a 75 lakhs down payment to get the 2 Mbps line. Today, it almost seems absurd, but that time. So in many ways, I think liberalization happened for India in 91. But I think this piece of OSP liberalization is a true liberalization for the Indian BPO industry, because luckily BPO and ITES and IT industry was away from legislation as much. And this was one piece of legislation which was kind of holding back the ITES companies. And I think this would be a big way to expand that. I think Sharmaji was saying about the size of the Indian IT industry. So it's about $220 billion this year, and it is expected to go to $300 billion by 2025. And it employs close to 4.5 million. But if you take indirectly, again, it'll be multifold. So Wii Technologies, we work in the healthcare industry. So we operate about 150 US-based hospitals. We do decision clinical support and analytics for these hospitals. And we also, part of that is we also do revenue cycle management. And a segment of it, we have to do phones. That's the only segment. But other than that, it's all data. So it's, to have an OSP license, we were almost feeling like an also-ran or a side act in a movie or something, because we were called the other service providers, so from that angle. So, and the other side of our business, we do engineering design services and architectural services and product engineering. So again, it's all data and it's nothing. So, and we employ 6,000 employees between US, India, and Philippines. And in the US, for example, 95% of our work is done work from home. And that's how we always operated. And in India, like what Nags was saying, we are in three cities of Bangalore, Chennai, and Salem. And I'm sure this would give us a big footprint across India go across other places as well. So I wouldn't go over a lot of what has already been discussed, like in terms of registration and call traffic over VPN was not allowed and things like that. And the calls would tend to be more expensive. And even interconnection between remote employees was not possible. Forget talking to somebody else. Even between employees, it was not possible. And in many ways, I think the COVID pandemic has helped usher in this thing in a faster way. So as this was the only option to kind of work. Because if you came to us and told us that we would be operating work from home last year in the way we are operating today, I don't think I would have even dreamt of it. So because it's such a change, and we didn't expect any of our clients to also allow us. But in many ways, it's a step in the right direction for India as such. Because like Rahul said, a client would come into India and they would use a US mobile phone and get on Wi-Fi and do calls over Wi-Fi using their mobile phone. So literally using as a local number, so they would call, but at the same time, our employees were not allowed. So a lot of times our managers had to stay back in the nights and work because when they go home, the connectivity isn't good. And so the day-night advantage, because I mean, I think 70% of India's ITES clients are US-based. So, and which meant that the day-night advantage or the day-night disadvantage for our managers. So our clients would say, why is India so backward? Because they don't see the data quality of actual working, but they would see the voice quality and then they would determine India, and it's a litmus test, right? So if the voice connection is bad, they would say India is a backward country or whatever. And because they were trying to take calls at home and the bandwidth was bad and like, you know, the internet connectivity wasn't good and things like that. So I think this is it's a true liberalization for more than an entrepreneur running a BPO company. It's a more liberalization for the employees of our own organizations, because now they can work from anywhere, and that gives them the freedom of choice to work from anywhere, like we were talking about. And it's a step in the right direction. Like, you know, so the government says minimum government, maximum governance. So even in our case, the work from home has enabled us to increase our governance right now, much before than where we were working from office. Because when we worked in office, we took certain things for granted and things like that. But now in terms of employee monitoring and things like that, it's really help that. So in many ways, I think we are a young country, and then we need to provide one job every 1.28 seconds. So in that, this ease of doing business would be a great step in the right direction. And as India emerges into Industry 5.0 is what I call it, manufacturing would be in the next 35, 40 years. And India would be handling 15% of the global economy in 2050. I think we are poised to become the manufacturing hub of the world, replacing China, because in 3D printing and designs and things like that, I think Indian engineering talent would be looked at much more than global talent. So I think it's a step in the right direction. So I congratulate Sharmaji for shepherding this process through, and I also congratulate Rahul for getting the legal, backroom work in terms of handling this. And I thank iSpirit and Sudhir for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Choco. Thank you very much for your inputs. So I've taken this discussion ahead. I think, Nags, I would like to pick up your line that you can't build companies from home, but you can, you know, create employment and, you know, operate from home. You know, the employees can operate from home. And that's one of the important thing in today's time. Pandemic has taught this to us. But it was important otherwise also, because a lot of IT industry does work in that way, right, sir? But more importantly, this build from an office but create employment within the country would probably usher in a lot of innovation, help a lot of software product companies, which is the mainstay of iSpirit, and we should talk about creating product nation. And so that will be enabled a lot by this reform, because small companies can have an office in maybe an important city or a tier 2, tier 3 city or a tier 1 city, but they could create jobs even in villages and towns, right? Because you don't need to be, you know, sitting in a city to be doing innovation, product development, kind of those things, right? Or maybe just doing a back office for a product company, or you know, even for international business or anything up like that. So I think innovation also, it will boost up, and we hope that this will go long way in coming years. As Nax, you said, in few years we will know the impact on the economy, on the industry that we'll have. So I think we have had a very good discussion. We have heard from everybody. If anybody has any other question or opinion to put in, let us give that chance. Otherwise, we can wrap up.
Let me try to answer Rahul's last question, which he had posed as to whether such reforms will be, you know, sort of done in many. See, what has happened is that especially in the ICT related areas, there have been tremendous development in technology. Technology has actually progressed very, very fast. However, the regulatory systems are all built for a physical world. You know, they are not really built for virtual world. And many people don't realize this part, that regulations need to be kind of, you know, changed, modified for this world. And many people are not able to grapple this whole change of, you know, approach. You know, I'll give you one example. I have been an administrator throughout my life, and I have worked for about 43 years. Now, when we started our careers as sub-divisional magistrates way back in Bihar in 1980s, you know, we were actually implementing CRPC and IPC and Evidence Act and all that. Now, in all that, there is a, you know, very strong place, a phrase or a definition called place of occurrence. Where does the event, you know, what date and time and place of occurrence? Now, this particular, in this virtual world, this place of occurrence is just not there. I mean, where is this whole virtual, you know, conference occurring? Tell me, you know, I am sitting in my home, Rahul is sitting in his own home. Everybody is, you know, different. So what is the POA in this? So what is actually required is essentially to grapple with this new reality. Also, we must realize that, look, we fortunately have had tremendous advantage, because after all, how did BPO, you know, the whole industry came in here? How did the ecosystem develop despite all these constraints? It developed, and Rahul rightly pointed out that at one particular point of time when it was supposed to be a red carpet, now it became a red tape, or it became a, you know, reverse the whole thing. It has happened in many sectors. And what is required is essentially we must have a relook at this. Also remember that, you know, we have a tremendous advantage that, as I said, you know, we developed this whole BPO system, and we have an advantage. We are an English speaking country. We are very bright boys and girls, and we can do things. Now, if we can, you know, if we just eliminate this advantage and create a disadvantage, it's a sad thing which will happen. And actually, this is an area, ICT is an area where we should be on top of this, on ahead in the curve, rather than just following certain things. And we have actually done a number of great things in the software space. Now, all of you are, you know, sort of aware of those UPI identity and all those stuff. I think we can, and we have the capability and brains to do that. So one is, I'm sure, Rahul, that, you know, we must actually examine each of our you know, systems, and then figure out as to which ones need to change. We had in TRAI had given two sets of recommendations, one to Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, another to the Department of Telecom, where we actually targeted ease of doing business. So basically we examined a whole set of regulations and rules and licensing regimes and everything. And we had said, these are the things which are required. And we had given explanation for each of them, rationale for each of them. And the whole idea is there is too much of, you know, for example, if somebody wants to take a channel license, or somebody wants to do, let's say, the information and broadcasting. Now, not only he has to give his balance sheet, et cetera, it may be a registered company, but then their balance sheet is also to be examined by another chartered accountant. And that is to be someone, I mean, it is ridiculous. That initial chartered accountant who prepared the balance sheet is actually the legal guy, legally the right person to have prepared the balance sheet. He has certain accountability. Now, this other guy who is just merely examining the same thing which this fellow has produced, what is the need for doing that? The guy just keep on paying him without any value addition. So there are such archaics, there are such, you know, obsolete kind of provisions which may have been, you know, done at one particular point of time because they may have had some relevance. But now after MCA 21 has come, everybody's, you know, balance sheet is on the website. It's all legally vetted. And it's a legal, digitally signed copy can be actually procured from MCA. There's no need for any other further thing. And I completely agree that, you know, we are great at, I don't know whether Mr. Nagaraj said or who said it, that, you know, we are great at converting. Bureaucracy is actually a great institution for converting the red carpet into red tape. You know, we are experts in that. Believe me, we are experts in that. So, and I have seen that, and I'm saying that with full responsibility, not by way of, you know, condemning anybody but as a system, we are all very safety oriented guys. And the last argument of bureaucracy is security. By security, dhwast ho jayega, lagta hai jaise desh doob jayega, agar aap isko khatam kar dijiyega to. This is a kind of, you know, logic which is bogus logic. We should understand this whole thing. The there are many compliances which are just useless compliances, because there are better methods for thieves and, you know, terrorists and other guys to, you know, go for. They can go for, you know, communication systems which are much more sophisticated and which are end-to-end encrypted, as they say. But still we are, you know, sort of security laga ke hum log usko garbad karte hain kai baar, aur ye hota hai, you know, hamara nature hai. This is the nature of the beast. The bureaucracies, you know, accountability hai, main pakda jaunga kal, to mujhe ye dekh lena chahiye, ye bhi dekh lena chahiye. Acha, usne diya, ek aadmi mere paas aaya, I was about to open a bank account. So he came to my home, and I'm opening these bank accounts because, you know, after retirement, I have some money which has been given as a provident fund, and I want to invest them so that I can get some regular income. So there was some bank which offers some 7%, you know, fixed deposit and all that. So this guy was interested, and I said, let me, you know, deposit 5 lakh rupees, because 5 lakh is the, even bank bhi dubega bhi tab bhi kam se kam 5 lakh rupees mujhe mil jayega. To wo aaya, to maine usko, I gave him the, you know, and I'm telling you, it's not bureaucracy alone, everybody who is in this kind of situation. So he came, and I gave him my Aadhaar letter. He said, sir, original Aadhaar letter dijiye mujhe. Maine kaha, bhaiya, ye original to hai ye. Bola, nahi, wo plastic pe chhapa hua. अरे भैया, प्लास्टिक पे छपा हुआ हो, चाहे कागज पे छपा हुआ हो, चाहे ताम्रपत्र पे छपा हुआ हो, साला आधार तो आधार ही हो, नंबर ही तो इम्पोर्टेंट है. Why should you? Then I gave him voter ID card. I gave him my driving license. But he kept on, and then he said, last thing was very great. He said, I want a digitally signed Aadhaar card. And I said, friend, digital signatures are on a bloody digital document. They are not on a paper document. You know, I can sign it myself. And bole, how do I know that you are you? Arey, maine kaha isi ke liye to Aadhaar banaya tha, yaar. So now that, believe me, that fellow did not open my account. I had a driving license. I had my, you know, sort of this voter ID card. And voter ID card original. I said, this is original, friend. And then I had the Aadhaar. And he said, no, I want Aadhaar only. And I want digitally signed Aadhaar. And I want original Aadhaar. So problem is that we all become absolutely, you know, bureaucratic, and we need to, you know, that's what I think the ease of doing business jo hum logon ne bataya hai. I think if somebody examines, maybe Sudhir, you can organize a similar brainstorming relating to the ease of doing business in telecom space, and maybe Rahul, you know, can do the background work of, you know, what are these things, and some of them are so obvious, boss, some of them are so obvious, they need to be done immediately, they need to be done yesterday. I think we need to go. I am very sure under our honorable prime minister, because I have seen how passionate he is towards, you know, ease of doing business, ease of living, he wants it. But I think we all need to come together, and we all need to sort of continuously do that. It's a great thing which has been done, actually, and I was so happy, and I complimented each one of the persons who are involved in it, including the Department of Telecom, saying that aapne bahut acha kiya hai. So I think things will continue to happen. I think our Prime Minister is absolutely aware of the need to carry these reforms in a major way, and I think things will happen. That's my response to Rahul. Maybe it's too optimistic, but that's what I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And I mean, great idea. I will take that idea further from you and maybe organize another event on ease of doing business, maybe a discussion with people as well visible as you are. And we could probably carve out some of the listed items to take it ahead. And we fully agree on the red tape thing. Thank you very much for the participation here and guiding us and, you know, making us more informed on the issue. Rahul, thank you very much for all the work that you have done in the background and make it happen. Nags, great ideas. I mean, I learned a lot from you and all the time. Choco, thank you very much for participation over here. So we'll wrap up this discussion now. We'll be posting this as a blog, both as a video as well as a text transcript of the blog. Thank you all. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.